Dr. Raj Chetty is the William A. Ackman Professor of Public Economics at Harvard University and Director of Opportunity Insights. Chetty's research combines empirical evidence and economic theory to help design more effective government policies. His work on tax policy, unemployment insurance, and education have been widely cited in media outlets and congressional testimony. His current research focuses on equality of opportunity with an emphasis on how can we give children from disadvantaged backgrounds better chances of succeeding. Dr. Chetty earned his AB summa cum laude and his PhD from Harvard University. Notably, at the age of 23, Dr. Chetty became a professor at the University of California, Berkeley, and later returned to Harvard as one of the youngest tenured professors in Harvard's history. Dr. Chetty also served as a faculty member at Stanford before returning to Harvard, where he rejoined the economics department and launched Opportunity Insights. Dr. Chetty has received numerous awards for his research, including a MacArthur Genius Fellowship and the John Bates Clark Medal, given to the economist under 40, whose work is judged to have made the most significant contribution to the field. He has also received the Sherwin Rosen Prize of the Society Labor of Economists and Kelvin Armanigal International Prize in Economics. Dr. Chetty was elected as a Fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2014 and as a member to the National Academy of Sciences in 2018. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Raj Chetty to the stage.
Thank you so much, Monica, for the warm introduction. Excuse me, and it's really a pleasure to be and an honor and a privilege to be with all of you here today. I think doing some of the most important work on trying to restore the American dream. And so I want to talk today, if we can bring the slides up here, about how we can make changes in colleges and institutions of higher education around the United States to restore the American dream. But I want to start at a much bigger picture level by talking about the American dream in a historical context. So of course, the American dream has many different facets and is a complicated concept that can mean different things to different people. But I want to start in this first chart here by distilling it to a simple measure that we can measure systematically in the data, which I think captures a cornerstone aspect of the American dream. It certainly was something that was very important to my own parents in coming to the United States. The idea that this is a country where through hard work, any child can expect to go on to have a higher standard of living than their parents did. So in a paper my colleagues and I wrote a few years ago, we set about to assess the extent to which America actually lives up to that aspiration, both today and historically. And what we did is measured the fraction of children who go on to earn more than their parents did, measuring both kids' and parents' incomes in their mid-30s and adjusting for inflation. And the result of that analysis, as shown in this chart here, where if you look at the far left, you can see that for kids born in the middle of the last century, it was a virtual guarantee that you were going to achieve the American dream of moving up. 92% of children born in 1940 went on to earn more than their parents did. But if you look at what has happened over time, you see a dramatic fading of the American dream, such that for children born in the middle of the 1980s, who are turning 30 around now when we're measuring their incomes, it's become essentially a coin flip, a 50-50 shot as to whether you're going to achieve the American dream and do better than your parents. Now, this dramatic trend is, of course, of great interest to economists like myself because it reflects a fundamental change in the American economy whose sources we'd like to understand. But I would argue it's also a fundamental social and political interest in our country because I think it's this very trend that underlies a lot of the frustration that people around the United States are expressing, that this is no longer a country where it's easy to get ahead, even if you work hard. And I think that's reflected in electoral outcomes and a lot of other social challenges that we're facing. And so this trend to me motivates in many ways the important work that folks in this room are doing and what lots of people in the US are concerned about. And so motivated by this trend, in our research group at Harvard Opportunity Insights, we're focused on that very big picture question of what is causing the fading of the American dream, and how can we, looking forward, restore the American dream and increase children's chances of rising up. Now, we are, of course, by no means the only folks to be thinking about these issues. There are scholars and policymakers who've been thinking about issues of inequality and opportunity for many decades. Our angle on it is to bring the tools of modern big data to bear on studying these questions. So much as you hear a lot nowadays about large data sets being used by companies like in Silicon Valley to improve the products they offer, our vision and what I hope to illustrate to you today is that the tools of big data can be useful in tackling important social and economic policy questions as well. Now, in structuring an analysis of any data of the type that I'm going to show you in a second, it's very useful to have a particular lens to focus on. One could focus on a particular topic, like, for instance, I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about education given this audience, and I'm going to show you that education plays a particularly important role in driving economic mobility. But I'm going to start out by taking a broader lens and take more of a life course perspective, talking about a broad range of interventions, things ranging from local structure of communities and housing and social capital, all of which I think play into driving economic mobility rather than focusing on any one particular domain. And I think that's, as you will see in the data, an extremely important way to approach this problem. The starting point for a lot of our analysis and what I'm going to discuss today is that there are very sharp local differences in rates of upward mobility across different communities in the United States. And I'm going to start with that geographic lens because I think understanding the community context in which community colleges operate, as Dr. Stout mentioned in her introductory remarks, is extremely valuable. So let me turn to the data and show you this map here, which illustrates the geography of upward mobility within America. Let me first describe how we construct this map and then tell you what I think we learn from it. So what we do in this analysis is take data on all kids born in the United States in the early 1980s, 20 million children, and use information from anonymized tax returns to link those kids to their parents and back to where they grew up. And using that enormous data set that allows us to follow children over time from where they grew up to how they're doing in adulthood, we construct a simple measure of upward mobility for 740 different metro and rural areas across the United States. We ask, what is the average income in adulthood around age 35 for kids who grew up in low-income families, that is families making about $27,000 a year, which puts them at the 25th percentile of the national income distribution. So we take the set of kids growing up in each of these different places in those low-income families, follow them over time using tax data, and ask, you know, how are they doing as adults? Have they reached the middle class? Have they gone beyond that? And so forth. We color the map so that blue-green colors represent areas with higher levels of upward mobility, and red and orange colors represent areas where kids have poorer prospects of rising up. If you start by looking at the scale in the lower right-hand side of this chart, you can see that even in present-day America, there's an enormous amount of variation in children's chances of rising up across different parts of the country. In some parts of the country, like in the rural Midwest, if you grow up in a family making $27,000 a year, on average, you're making more than $50,000 or $55,000 a year in the next generation. So that's an enormous amount of upward mobility in a single generation. The American dream is well and alive in places like Dubuque, Iowa, for example. But in contrast, if you look at the places in the darkest red colors, take a place like Charlotte, North Carolina, for example, kids growing up in families at the exact same income level, $27,000 a year, one generation later are actually making less than their parents were on average, $26,300, which is, I think, remarkable and disturbing given the fact that there has been a tremendous amount of economic growth in the US over the past 30 years and a tremendous amount of economic progress in Charlotte in particular. So this map illustrates that, you know, if someone asks you, is the American dream well and alive? The answer is that it really depends upon which part of America you're talking about. And that is, I think, very useful to understand because it shows that depending upon in which community context you're operating, the set of challenges you face might be very different. Now, this map is also very useful from my perspective as a researcher and a scientist. It's very valuable from a scientific perspective because it gives us a new lens to study the determinants of economic mobility that we've never had in the past. Think of it as sort of the analog of having a microscope for the first time in the social sciences, where we're able to look at the data not just at a national level, but really break it down and ask, you know, in different parts of the country, in different subgroups, where are people doing well and where are they not? And why is that so useful? You can then start to ask, you know, what's different about Salt Lake City or the West Coast of the US relative to the Southeast that's driving such big differences in upward mobility? What can we learn from those comparisons? And what can we potentially do going forward to increase upward mobility throughout the United States? So what I'm going to do in the next few minutes is lay out what we've learned from a scientific perspective about the drivers of economic mobility, and then show you how those lessons can be used to implement changes in colleges in particular, and community colleges in particular, to drive economic mobility going forward. So what I'm gonna do first is walk through a series of explanations for what might be driving these sharp differences in economic mobility that we're seeing across different communities in the United States. You might already have some potential explanations in your own mind from looking at this map on what might be going on. So one prominent explanation that people often think of, especially economists, is that maybe this is about differences in the types of jobs or differences in the labor markets across these areas. So there's some places, for instance, the Bay Area, where the tech sector has been thriving over the past 30 years. Maybe that's what's leading to relatively high rates of economic mobility there. So to assess that, let me turn to this chart here, where we're taking the data from the map that I just showed you, the data on upward mobility, here shown for the 30 largest cities in the US, and we're putting that on the vertical axis, and we're plotting that against simple measures of job growth rates from 1990 to 2010, the period over which the kids in our sample were growing up, just as a way of assessing the extent to which these cities were growing in terms of their economies over time. And what you can see when you look at this chart is that there's basically not much of a connection between these two variables. In particular, as I was saying earlier, you have places like Charlotte and Atlanta, for example, which are two of the most rapidly growing cities in America. If you look at any standard measure of how many jobs there are, how many high-paying jobs there are, how much people are making in those cities, it would be very clear that those are some of the most rapidly growing cities in the US. They're sort of the engine of jobs in the Southeast. But if you look at these new data that I'm showing you here, where we follow people longitudinally over time, look at kids growing up in low-income families in Charlotte and Atlanta, you can see that those kids, unfortunately, are not actually benefiting from that economic growth. Despite the fact that those cities are growing so rapidly, Charlotte and Atlanta have some of the lowest rates of upward mobility in the United States. So the first thing you might wonder is, you know, how is that even possible arithmetically? How could it be that on average incomes are going up in Charlotte and Atlanta, yet the kids who are growing up there are not experiencing upward mobility? So the way I think about it is that those cities are effectively importing talent. Lots of people move to places like Charlotte and Atlanta to get jobs at firms like Bank of America, which is headquartered in Charlotte, which are very high-paying jobs. But what we're seeing is, in these data, those people who are getting those jobs are not the kids growing up in low and middle-income families in those cities. So why is that point so important in our context here, talking about education? What this illustrates is that the simple solution that many people think of in a local context, that we should make efforts to get the biggest employers to move to our city, bid for the headquarters of Amazon to move to a particular city, that can potentially be valuable, but it's not in and of itself the solution. As you can see here, you really need to connect people to those high-paying jobs in a deliberate way and provide them with the skills in order to get those jobs, in order to create that upward mobility. And that, of course, is going to create a very important role, I think, for the higher education system to make that connection. So first, simple but I think important point, this is not just about jobs. We have to think specifically about human capital and skill development in specific communities. Now, coming back to the big map here, so we've talked about how this is not just about jobs. Well, so what is it about? Second potential explanation that many people think of, anyone familiar with the demography of the United States would recognize that there's a potential connection to race here. In particular, the places in the red and orange colors on this map tend to be the places with larger African-American populations, places like the Southeast, the industrial Midwest, cities like Detroit, Cleveland, and so forth. Now, we all know that there's a long history of racial disparities in the United States, and so you might wonder how much of the difference that we're seeing in economic mobility across these places is about differences by race in terms of chances of moving up, as opposed to differences by place. So to get at that, what we did next is link the information from the tax records that I used to construct the map that I just showed you to data from the census covering the entire US population, which gives us information on everyone's race and ethnicity. And what that allows you to do is construct this pair of maps here, where we're looking at the same data on upward mobility, but separately now for black men on the left and white men on the right. The same exact statistics, take a set of kids who start out in low-income families, ask where they end up as adults. So when you first look at these maps, many people have the reaction that, oh, you know, they put these two maps on two different color scales, kind of a red-orange color scale on the left and a blue-green color scale on the right. But if you look at the bottom of the slide, you can see that, in fact, we have not put these maps on separate color scales. They're on the same color scale. It's just that there is such an extreme difference in rates of upward mobility between black and white men that it's almost like you're living in two different countries. To put it a little bit more precisely, the very best places in terms of upward mobility for black men, a place like Boston, for example, where a black man growing up in a low-income family can expect to have, on average, an earnings of about $25,000 a year, they have lower levels of upward mobility there than the places with the lowest levels of upward mobility for white men, a place like Charlotte, North Carolina, for example. So it's really like you have two distinct set of opportunities by race for black men versus white men. Now, I want to underscore the importance of this fact, particularly in the context of Black History Month, in the context of ongoing debates about affirmative action in higher education in the United States, because what this really underscores is how important race is in America, even today, even conditional on class. So we're using very precise information from tax returns to control for people's incomes, look at people who are starting out at the same baseline, and what we're finding is that there's an enormous difference in economic opportunities by race. Even if you look at two kids who are starting out in the exact same socioeconomic class, you can look at kids in the same schools, the same types of environments, race has a profoundly important role in the US even today, and I think that's something that is worth being reminded of and extremely important to address going forward in the coming years. Now, what these data show is that race is incredibly important in the context of comparing black men and white men. You'll notice that I subset the data by gender here. Why did I do that? If you now replicate the exact same analysis for women, you see a very different picture. If you look at rates of economic mobility for black women on the left and white women on the right, you see that the spectrum of colors in these two maps basically looks the same as each other. More broadly, we find that rates of economic mobility for black and white women measured in various ways look very comparable to each other. And so that's useful to recognize because it shows that the challenges we face in terms of racial disparities in the US really seem to emerge, in particular, from differences between black and white men. And so that might make you think about a particular set of challenges related to things like the criminal justice system, related to things like discrimination in the labor market that might be affecting black men in particular. Whatever the cause is, it shows that we need to focus on understanding the challenges that black men in particular are facing in order to narrow racial disparities. So what we've seen so far is that race seems to play a really important role in driving differences in economic opportunity, but I want to emphasize that even conditional on race, if you look, for instance, at the map on the right, there's a lot of difference remaining in people's chances of rising up, even for people of a given race, even among white folks, even among black folks. And so the next step in our analysis, and there's a series of studies that have now been done on this, is to try to understand what is it that's driving these differences across places for people of a given race. And so in the interest of time, I'm going to summarize very briefly what a series of research studies have identified as the most important determinants of these differences in economic mobility across areas. And let me just read these off. So first, we find that places with lower levels of poverty rates, more mixed income communities, tend to have higher levels of economic mobility. Second, a strong pattern in the data is places with more stable family structures. For instance, more two-parent families, for example, tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. A third pattern, which I'm going to spend a lot more time talking about, is that places with better schools, both at the K through 12 level and access to high-quality higher education, tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. And a fourth important factor, and I'm going to come back to this theme repeatedly through this talk, is that places with greater social capital tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Now, this idea of social capital is something that economists and sociologists have talked about for more than 100 years. It's something that I think many people intuitively feel might be quite important, the strength of your community, who you're connected to. A lot of us, you know, based on introspection, have the sense that this can make a big difference in people's lives. But traditionally, it's been something that's been very difficult to measure, quantify, and figure out how you might change. So in some recent work, the most recent work our research team has done, we decided to try to take a stab at understanding social capital more precisely, seeing if we could measure it and understand its determinants and its potential connection to economic mobility. And so what we did is turn to a very different data source. We set up a collaboration with Meta, the company that operates the Facebook social network, and we used data from Facebook to measure interaction across class lines across the United States. So kind of a big data way to think about one form of social capital. So again, let me describe how we construct this map and then tell you what I think the lessons are. So what we're doing here is for every county in America, we're taking the set of people between ages of 25 and 44 who are using Facebook. Facebook covers roughly 85% of the US population in that age range. And we're asking, if you are a low-income person in the US, you have below median income, living in a given county, what fraction of your friends on Facebook have above median income? So it's a simple way of measuring the extent to which low-income folks living in a given area are interacting with or are connected to higher-income folks. We color the map here so that blue colors are places with more cross-class connection, and red-orange colors are places with more disconnection across class lines. So when you look at this map, you probably recognize immediately that that map looks incredibly similar to the maps that I was showing you of economic mobility constructed using completely different data, constructed using the tax records a few slides ago, right? So in particular, places like the rural Midwest tend to have more cross-class interaction. They're also the places with the highest levels of economic mobility. We can see that more systematically if we go to a chart like this, very similar to what I was showing you with the job growth analysis. We're putting the same data on upward mobility here on the vertical axis, but now instead of correlating that with rates of job growth, we're correlating that with these measures of economic connectedness, cross-class interaction, the share of high-income friends that low-income people have on Facebook. And here you can see these two variables are incredibly tightly related to each other. Places with more cross-class interaction tend to be places with higher levels of upward mobility. And that turns out to be the strongest predictor of economic mobility that anyone has identified to date, and explains actually a lot of the other relationships that people have found in the past, that communities that are more segregated, for example, have lower levels of economic mobility. Now, I've shown you all of this data in the context of differences across areas. What I'm going to turn to next is how we can use this set of findings to inform how we might change things on the ground going forward to increase economic mobility, recognizing that race seems to matter, recognizing that economic connectedness seems to matter, that there are these sharp differences across places and so forth. And so in our research team, as I was saying at the outset, we focus on various different domains that we think could be important in terms of increasing mobility going forward. Given this view of the world that the roots of economic mobility are hyper-local, it really matters which particular community you grow up in, and actually I didn't show this data here, but you can drill down below the county level and show that the specific block or which part of a city you're growing up in has a profound effect on your long-term prospects. When you have that perspective on the world, you naturally think about three different strategies to try to increase economic mobility. So the first thing you might think about doing is to reduce segregation and help folks move to communities where we see better prospects of rising up. A second approach, recognizing that you can't possibly move everyone, not everyone wants to move, is to make strategic place-based investments to try to revitalize communities where levels of opportunity are currently low. And the third, and the domain that I'm going to focus on here, given the context and given this audience, is improving higher education. So the key touch point for most kids after age 18 is, of course, not the home where they're growing up, but rather the institution of higher education that they might attend. And I think there's an enormous amount that we can do through institutions of higher education to increase economic mobility in those red-colored areas in the maps that I was showing you. So let me, in the remaining half of this talk, focus in on that particular avenue and start with this simple chart here, just to frame the discussion on higher education, which is just starting with the basic question of who is attending college in the United States. And these are going to be statistics that you're familiar with from other contexts. Here's just a simple measure using tax record data for the entire US population. What fraction of kids go to college by parent income? There are 100 dots here, one for each percentile of the parent income distribution. Lowest income kids on the left, kids raised in the top 1% highest income families on the far right. And you can see there's a remarkable strong relationship in the US between your parents' income and your chances of attending college, even today. Kids from the highest income families, virtually 100% of them end up going to college. Kids from the lowest income families, something like 30% of them end up going to college at all. And this is, I should note, simply attending college. We're not talking about completing college here. This is literally, do you attend for at least 1 year? And so this incredibly strong gradient is a first, you know, clue and a first factor that, through which higher education may actually amplify disparities across generations, right? Because kids from higher income families are getting this additional education that's opening doors and giving them access to higher paying jobs that kids from lower income families are not. But this is only scratching the surface of, I think, the equity issues in the higher education sector that we need to tackle, because it's not just whether you go to college or not that varies tremendously with parent income. It's also which college you attend and the types of resources that you and opportunities you have as a result of that. So to drill down into that further, what I'm going to talk about in much of the remainder of the talk is a series of analyses we've done, again using data from tax records, covering 30 million students, essentially all college students in the US over the past 15 years or so. And we're taking that data and linking it to information from tax records to follow kids over time and understand who is attending each college in America and what kids' outcomes look like college by college in the United States. So I'm going to walk through a series of colleges. For concreteness and as a point of reference, let me start with my own institution, Harvard University, and first talk about the parental income distribution at Harvard. So who is attending Harvard, and this is going to be representative, as you'll see in a second, of other highly selective private colleges. So this is the parental income distribution of students at Harvard, roughly at present or in the past 10 years or so. And you can see here that Harvard is incredibly tilted towards kids from high-income families. Only 3% of kids come from the bottom 20% of the income distribution. 70% come from the top 20% of the parental income distribution. And what's more, 15% or so come from the top 1% of the parental income distribution. That's families making more than about $650,000 a year. And so what that implies, if you combine those statistics, is that your chance of attending Harvard is about 100 times higher if you happen to be born to parents in the top 1% of the income distribution compared to the bottom 20% of the income distribution. So Harvard, you know, this fact basically implies that Harvard and institutions like it cannot be contributing a whole lot to economic mobility because they are incredibly skewed towards kids from very high income families. They're not really serving kids from lower and middle income families, despite the fact that there's been tremendous attention paid to those issues at those institutions, expansions of financial aid, and so forth. Okay, so I want to use this mainly as a contrast. I want to spend more time focusing on community colleges, which I think have a much larger role to play in terms of increasing economic mobility. But this is, I think, a useful point of contrast. And so what I'm going to do now is use this chart, which I'm going to animate and show you data for various colleges, starting with the data point for Harvard that I just discussed. And I want to talk about two different axes that matter for economic mobility. So the first, which is what I just discussed, is the fraction of students who come from low-income families, just in measure of access. So what fraction of kids, for example, come from families in the bottom 20% of the income distribution? We saw that number for Harvard was at 3%, and that's why Harvard is on the far left side of this chart. But what matters for economic mobility is not just who is attending your college, but how well kids do after college as well. On this dimension, Harvard does incredibly well. The low-income kids, the few low-income kids who attend Harvard, when we follow them over time in the tax record data, we see that something like 60% of them end up reaching the top fifth of the income distribution. So on the vertical axis here is a measure of what we're calling the upward mobility rate. Take the set of kids who come from families in the bottom 20% and ask what fraction of them reach the top 20% after college, 10 years after college or so. And you can see at Harvard, 60% of them do. You know, the vast majority of these kids are reaching the upper middle class or well beyond. So Harvard propels children who attend there, you know, into the upper middle class or beyond, but enrolls very few low-income kids. So now let's look at those same two dimensions for all of the colleges in America, each shown by a different dot on this plot, okay? And now I'm gonna, you can see a very clear pattern here, which is we have some colleges that tend to cater mainly to higher income kids. They enroll very few low-income kids. And like Harvard, they have very good outcomes. And then you have many other colleges that serve lots of low-income kids that are on the right side of this chart. But unfortunately, at present, they don't tend to launch a lot of those kids into the middle class or beyond. And so what I want to do is walk through what these different colleges are and talk about what this kind of analysis means in terms of how we can increase economic mobility college by college going forward. So let's look at a few different clusters of colleges. So as a reference point, let me start again with the elite private Ivy League sort of colleges that I was just discussing. You can see those are all like Harvard clustered in the upper left. They are colleges that at present don't really serve many low-income kids. They have terrific outcomes, but when you combine those two things, they can't be contributing a whole lot to economic mobility simply because they are not admitting, their inputs are not kids from lower income families. So when we started to do this work, our conjecture was that it might be the state flagship institutions that might contribute the most to economic mobility. So let's look at that group of colleges next. And so that's what's highlighted in the red here. We've highlighted a selected set of state flagship institutions, places like the University of California, Berkeley, University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and so forth. And you can see that that conjecture that we had was actually completely wrong. These colleges also, it turns out, don't really serve a lot of low-income kids. They look pretty similar to places like Harvard and other private colleges in terms of the share of low-income students. Their outcomes in terms of how well kids are doing after college don't actually look, they're close to what we see at the private colleges. They're certainly not dramatically better. And so as a result, they actually have lower rates of economic mobility. They're channeling fewer kids from the bottom to the top relative to other colleges. So you might be wondering, well, what are the colleges in America that are actually contributing significantly to economic mobility? Conceptually, you basically want to think about colleges that are on the upper right side of this chart that both admit a lot of low-income students and tend to have pretty good outcomes after college. So what are those few dots that you're seeing in the upper right there? So let me just give you a list of what those colleges are. Here's a list of the top colleges in America in terms of the fraction of kids who start out in low-income families and end up reaching the top fifth of the income distribution. So to give you an example, Cal State Los Angeles is a place where 10% of kids, one out of every 10 kids at that university, come from a family in the bottom 20% of the income distribution, and after college end up in the top 20% of the income distribution. Again, I want to stress that all of the statistics I'm showing you here are not conditioned on completion. This is just conditioned on attendance. It's just saying among the kids who ever attended Cal State LA, one out of 10 experienced this trajectory, which is, you know, really a remarkable leap from the bottom to the top, if you think about it. So you look more generally at this list, you know, you see places like the City University of New York, Glendale Community College in Los Angeles, Cal State Poly, UTexas El Paso, and so forth. How would I characterize these institutions? They are not the state flagship institutions. They're you might think of as mid-tier public institutions that are serving a very large number of kids from lower income and middle income families and producing pretty good outcomes for those children. Now, I also want to go into more detail. Specifically, there's some community colleges that were listed on that slide. I want to show you some data for additional community colleges. And I'll note that you can look up data for your own colleges on a handy website that the New York Times has created using these statistics. If you just Google New York Times college mobility, you can type in your own college and look up these statistics. Now, some of the colleges that have been highlighted in green here I know are participants in this conference here today, and so you can look at your own data. You can see places like Kingsborough Community College, part of the CUNY system, Harper College, and so forth, all of which, you know, I think there are two interesting things to note. A lot of these colleges have pretty good outcomes in terms of rates of upward mobility in the grand scheme of things. They may not be at the top of the spectrum, but many of them have quite good outcomes. But what I was struck by is there's also a lot of dispersion in terms of access. So some of these colleges are enrolling many more kids from low-income families than others, despite all of them being community colleges. And what that shows is, on the access dimension, there's a lot of variation even within community colleges, something that I think we need to pay attention to going forward, in addition to thinking about outcomes. Now, doing the same kind of analysis that I was just describing, you can combine this data on access and on kids' outcomes after college to construct measures of mobility rates, what fraction of the student body at present is coming from a low-income family and reaching the top of the income distribution. And you can do that for each of these colleges and all of the other colleges in the data. And you can see, for example, you know, the CUNY system in general, Kingsborough Community College in particular, has a very high rate of mobility. There are lots of kids coming from low-income families who are ending up doing quite well. Broward also has a much higher rate of mobility than the typical College America. And there's presently quite a bit of variation across these colleges. And by looking at these types of data for your own college, you can start to assess, you know, if I want to increase my contribution to economic mobility in the US, do I need to think about the access dimension? Do I need to think about who's entering the college? Or do I need to focus on outcomes after college as a way to increase economic mobility? And so on that note, in the remaining time, I want to talk about how we can take these data and develop strategies to increase economic mobility on a college-by-college basis going forward. And I would basically divide the approaches that we should be thinking about into two different types of strategies. And if you come back to this chart, you can think about it as two different ways visually of trying to tackle the problem of getting more colleges into the upper right side of this chart. So the first strategy is to expand low-income access to highly selective colleges. So if you've got these colleges in the upper left, like I was describing Harvard and those other highly selective colleges, you know, how do we increase access to those universities, increase the number of low-income students on those campuses? I think that's very valuable to think about. It's very valuable to think about for community colleges as well, because I think increasingly going forward, transfers to four-year institutions can play a very important role in creating pathways to economic mobility, and I think that can be part of the way you diversify the student body at many of these selective four-year institutions. Now, often people wonder, is there really a capacity for colleges themselves to change things, or is a lot of it baked in by the time you apply to college because of the many disparities that kids face while they're growing up? You know, access to weaker schools, more segregated environments, fewer resources, lower parental incomes, et cetera. Is that setting kids behind such that, you know, it's very difficult for selective colleges to sort of address the problem by themselves? So as one way to show you that I actually think there's a very big role that colleges can play, here's an analysis where we try to take a set of kids who have similar credentials as measured in one way using SAT and ACT scores at the point of college application, and we're looking at your chance of attending a highly selective, say, Ivy League college by parent income. So if you look at the green curve, for example, that is for a set of kids, all of whom have SAT scores of exactly, let's say, 1,500. And what you can see is even among those kids who have the exact same level of SAT scores, kids from high-income families are far more likely to be attending these highly selective colleges where we tend to see the best outcomes after college relative to kids from lower income families and middle income families. So what that shows you is it's not just about what's happening before college. A lot of these disparities are emerging in terms of who's actually ending up at these institutions, even having the same academic credentials at the point of applying to college. So given that, what can colleges potentially do to diversify their student bodies? I think we're starting to accumulate evidence on what can really work in this context. Let me give you a couple of examples. So one, I think, nice example is a program that the University of Michigan implemented, where they did a series of personalized mailings to low-income, high-achieving students in Michigan to encourage them to apply to the University of Michigan, provided some support in that process, gave them a guaranteed scholarship that they were already eligible for but might not have known about. And in a randomized trial, a nice study by Sue Donarski, my colleague at Harvard, that study showed that that intervention, which is a very low-cost intervention, increased the enrollment rate at the University of Michigan for these high-achieving, low-income students from 12% to 27%, which I think will dramatically change the trajectories of these kids and significantly increase their economic mobility. So one example of a type of intervention that can make a difference. Now, that's one strategy to try to expand access. The other strategy, which is I think in some ways more important and what I see a lot of you as being, I think, correctly focused on, is how we can improve outcomes at institutions that are currently serving lots of low-income students, but where on this chart we're not seeing such great outcomes after college. And again, I think we're starting to accumulate evidence from a series of interventions that people have attempted and have rigorously evaluated on what can really make a difference. And again, let me just pick out a couple of examples where there have been particularly rigorous research studies. So one that I suspect many of you are familiar with, the CUNY ASAP program, a comprehensive social support program for low-income community college students in the CUNY system, again, through experimental and quasi-experimental methods, has been shown to nearly double graduation rates from 22% to 40% and commensurately improve outcomes after college as well. So I think those kinds of social support programs, coming back, linking back to the importance of social capital that I talked about earlier, for being connected to folks who can support you in the process above and beyond just giving people financial resources, I think can really make a difference as illustrated by this one program as an example. There are also, I think, a number of interesting programs that go outside the traditional sphere of colleges themselves and focus on the link between colleges and employers. So I want to give you an example of that from Charlotte, which I talked about as being one of the lowest upward mobility cities in the US. So when our team put out that data a few years ago, people in Charlotte became very concerned about that data, and they noted in their local newspaper that Charlotte is not really a land of opportunity, that this is a wake-up call, that they really needed to change things in Charlotte and so forth. And what came out of that, I think, is an initiative that's very illustrative of the types of things that are feasible going forward. Bank of America, which as I mentioned is headquartered in Charlotte, set up a program to hire 1,000 people who grew up in disadvantaged communities in Charlotte itself. They recognized that, you know, apparently even though we're creating lots of high-paying jobs, we're not actually serving the local community. So let's try to hire folks who grew up here in lower income families. And they recognized that at present, you know, they might not have people with the skill sets that they wanted to hire. So they teamed up with the local community college and with the Year Up sectoral job training program that some of you might have heard of, a nonprofit that I think is doing great work in this space. And they set up a program to try to provide people with the skills and the networks needed to get the specific jobs they were looking to hire for at Bank of America. And the results of that, again, you can evaluate systematically with a randomized trial. You can compare people who had access to the Year Up program in an earlier randomized trial with people who didn't. So the green curve here is people who got a chance to participate in the Year Up job training program. The orange curve did not. And you can see right after they complete the program, there's something like a 35% increase in earnings that sustained for many, many years afterward. So that's another example of a program where I think community colleges can work in tandem with local businesses and possibly nonprofits to increase their impacts on economic mobility in really a provable and potentially scalable way. Now, a key theme in that I think is a common theme in a lot of these programs that we're seeing are highly effective is that they do a lot more than simply give people technical skills or financial resources. As I was emphasizing earlier, they really provide that broader social connection, wraparound service, connections to people in positions of influence who might be able to hire you, who might mentor you, who might change your trajectory. That really seems to be quite important in driving success, and I think should be an element of many programs that we think about going forward. So let me, in the interest of time, with a couple of minutes left, I'm gonna skip some of these details here and wrap up by talking about what I think leaders in higher education can do going forward to increase economic mobility, and then end with a different way of thinking about these issues that will hopefully be useful as you advocate for change in your own communities. So taking everything that I've shared with you today, what we're seeing in the research, what we're seeing in the data, I would summarize with four broad lessons. First, I think really being deliberate about recognizing the community that's a part of community college, figuring out how to recruit students from local communities that particularly have low rates of upward mobility, where you can see in the data that we have now made public, you can look up different cities, you can look up different neighborhoods within your city, you can ask, where are people not really having access to opportunity? How can we recruit students from those communities? I think that's a very systematic way in which you can amplify the impacts you're having on upward mobility going forward in a data-driven manner. So that's one simple lesson. Second, as I was just emphasizing, conditional on having a set of students at your college, providing social support to students from lower income families, and increasing the degree of economic connectedness, the degree of cross-class interaction that you're seeing on campus between students, that really seems to be a key predictor of success afterwards. So building those communities in deliberate ways, as some of these programs are starting to do, I think is very valuable. Third, I think looking beyond college itself and supporting things like sectoral job training programs in partnership with local businesses, I think can be very fruitful. And finally, as I hope I've illustrated here, using the tools of modern big data to systematically measure progress and not simply try many different initiatives that we think might be promising, but really try to evaluate systematically what is working and what is not, I think can be incredibly valuable. So let me end in the last minute here by giving you a different perspective on why I think the work that you're all doing on these issues is so important. So many of us, myself included, I think are inspired to think about these issues by motivations of justice, of equality of opportunity, of giving everyone a fair shot of the American dream. But there's a different way to look at it, sort of more of an economist's view, that I think is also important and can be incredibly important in making an appeal for support for these kinds of programs, which is that creating more equity and giving more kids access to education and the kinds of pathways we're talking about can be incredibly important simply for economic growth and expanding the size of the pie in America. So in some other analysis we've done, we've looked at who goes on to become an inventor in America as measured by having a patent, or who goes on to start an influential business in America. And what you can see in this chart is that if you're from a high-income family, you're much more likely to pursue a career that is likely to impact lots of other people in society. You invent a new drug, you start a new business, et cetera. And so what that means is we basically have a phenomenon of what we call lost Einsteins in the US, where there are lots of kids who are basically being left behind, who are not coming through the pipeline, who could be, you know, making important discoveries, starting businesses that would tremendously benefit everyone in society. And we estimate through these kinds of data that if women, minorities, and kids from low-income families were to invent at the same rate as high-income white men, for example, we would have four times as many inventors in America as we currently do. So there's really just a tremendous amount of talent that I think is being lost because we don't have the systems in place yet to try to bring this talent through the pipeline. And so that, to me, is another argument, even setting aside issues of justice, if you just care about improving the bottom line, increasing tax revenue, having a stronger economy, you want to be investing tremendously in solving the types of problems we've just been talking about. And as I hope I've illustrated, I think community colleges, colleges in general and community colleges in particular, can play a great role in solving that problem. So let me stop there and thank you all so much for your attention and all of your work.